Welcome once again. Right now we're at 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 all the way through to the end of the chapter. Paul continues his letter saying, don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. So you might say, what does this mean, don't be unequally yoked? You see, in the old days, they used to have some animals tied or yoked to a millstone, and they would all walk in circles pulling this millstone, and that is what they would use to, you know, grind things like wheat and such. So if the animals are unequally yoked, it just doesn't work. There's no production. I mean, the millstone won't turn. So you have to have animals of equal size, of equal strength, all going in the same direction in order for it to work. So this particular phrase, don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers, is in fact talking about working with people, two or more people working together. And I know a lot of Christians, they use this verse when it comes to like getting married or, you know, finding a girlfriend or boyfriend or that kind of thing. And so, yeah, this can be applied to that, but it's not limited to that. In fact, it's talking more about working together with other people. Now, of course, if you're getting married, of course, if you're, you know, you want to find a spouse, then, you know, this would apply because you have to work together in life, you know, so this would certainly apply to that, but it's not limited to that. This is also talking about, you know, work in general, or just being, or just, you know, hanging out with people in general. Like if you're really a believer and you're hanging out with an unbeliever, then yeah, there'd be some things you might have in common, but really, if you're a real believer, I mean, your primary focus in life is God. Your primary purpose in life is God's purpose. And so you really don't have a lot of things in common. Now, I want to mention this as well, that a lot of people say, well, you know what, this particular person, I'm interested in this person. You know, I'm thinking about maybe getting serious with this person. If you are a female, if you are a woman, and you're looking at a man who is just doesn't really, you know, meet the specs per se when it comes to the spiritual things, guess what? Just forget it. Because according to the scriptures, the man is the priest, the high priest of the home. Just as the people don't lead the priest, so the woman doesn't lead the man. Now, I know there are rare exceptions where the wife could influence the man to get saved and so on, you know, so on and so forth. But that is the rare exception. Don't go by that, okay? You have to have a man that is a real good, strong believer, a real good, strong leader that would make a real good priest, okay? The priest leads the people, not the people leading the priest. If the people lead the priest, I mean, it's backwards. You don't want that at all. So Paul says, don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. For what fellowship do righteousness and iniquity have? If you're a true believer, you stand for righteousness. And unbelievers, well, they stand for iniquity. What fellowship does righteousness have with iniquity? Or what fellowship does light have with darkness? Have you ever walked into a dark room and flicked the light switch and say, hey, the light and the darkness is fellowshipping. They're getting along fine together. The light is not driving the darkness away. It's just coexisting with the darkness. The light, the bright light and the darkness is coexisting. It never happens. It does not happen. The true light shines and drives out the darkness. What agreement does Christ have with Belial? Belial is another name for the devil. Now, this is where we get our word liar from, because another form of Belial is belier, okay? Remember, Jesus said that the native language of the devil is lies. So he's called belier. Now, belier doesn't necessarily mean liar. It actually has a connotation of being, you know, empty or vain, that kind of thing, okay? So belier and Belial are the same thing. And it's from that particular word that we get our word liar from. So what agreement does Christ have with the devil? Or what portion does a believer have with an unbeliever? What agreement does a temple of God have with idols? Don't forget, unbelievers are idol worshipers. Now, they might not have, you know, statues in their home that they bow down to, or they might not go to a temple of idols, you know, physically, literally, but they do have idols. And those things are just as much of an idol as any other kind of idol would be. Now, I'm talking about money. I'm talking about self. That's a big one. A lot of people have an idol in their life, and their idol is their self. It could be celebrities, politicians, you know, musicians, anything like that, okay? Things, something that you are, you know, that you love more than you love God. And an unbeliever loves at least one thing, if not a lot of things, more than they love God. Because if they're an unbeliever, they don't even really follow the ways of God at all. So what agreement does the temple of God have with idols? For you are a temple of the living God. Even as God said, I will dwell in them and walk in them. I will be their God and they will be my people. Again, Paul, of course, quotes the Torah and the Tanakh to substantiate his doctrine. Leviticus chapter 26, verse 12, he references. Also, Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 38. And Ezekiel chapter 37, verse 27. Therefore, quote, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. Touch no unclean thing, I will receive you. And again, Paul quotes the so-called Old Testament. Yeshayahu, or Isaiah, chapter 52, verse 11. Ezekiel, chapter 20, verse 34 and 41. I will be to you a father. You will be to me sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 14, and chapter 7, verse 8. This here is a very, very profound thing. God says, come out from among them, be separate, don't touch an unclean thing, and I will receive you. When God says, don't touch the unclean thing, he means don't get defiled by it, okay? Remember, Jesus, he was a doctor to the sick. He was with the sinners, but he didn't fellowship with them. He was with them to heal them of their sin. Remember, his first and foremost message was repent. Same with all of the disciples. So Jesus was the doctor to the sick. He was the preacher of repentance and the preacher of conviction to the sinner. He wasn't hanging out and condoning or, you know, blinding himself to the sin in the lives of the sinner. If you go to a good doctor and you have a disease, if that's a good doctor, that doctor's not going to blind his eyes to that disease and say, oh, I don't even see it. I'll just pretend like it's not even there. If you have a doctor like that, get a new doctor. That's not the way Jesus is. He will point it out. You have sin, and here it is. Repent of that sin. Turn from that sin. Don't do it anymore. Like he said time and time again, go and sin no more. No tolerance there to sin, okay? Then God says, I will receive you. I will be to you a father, and you will be my sons and daughters. So come out from among them. That doesn't mean that you have to leave this earth, okay? You can be in the world, but not of the world. You can be amongst the believers, but not fellowshipping with them. In other words, you don't laugh at their jokes. You don't do what they do. You are there. You are there as a light, shining a light, okay? I remember in a place I used to work, like going into the men's change room, and it's like, you know, I could hear the filthy language, and I could hear all the stuff going on before I got into the room. I mean, as soon as they saw me, some of the guys, they wouldn't be using the same kind of words that they used in my absence. And that's the way you should be. Now, I read a story about an old revivalist, and he would get on a train. And when he got on a train, you know, somebody would just jump up and say, you convict me of sin, even though that preacher didn't even say a word. And even though it seems like that person who jumped up and said, you convict me of sin, didn't even know that that was a preacher. I mean, that's the light, that's the glory, that's the presence of God that should be on every believer. So instead of mingling with the sinners, you should be there as a light to the sinners And instead of being influenced by them, you are to influence them. So yes, you are among them, but not fellowshipping with them. It's not, it's one thing to be, you know, acquaintances with them. Now remember, the Pharisees accused Jesus of being a friend of sinners. It doesn't say in the scriptures that Jesus was a friend of sinners. In fact, who were the sinners? Who were the sinners in Jesus' day? If anything, it was the Pharisees. Was Jesus a friend of the Pharisees? He would rebuke them for their sin over and over and over again. How much of a friend was he to the Pharisees, okay? The Pharisees, they tried to accuse Jesus of being a friend to sinners. Now, what they didn't realize is these so-called sinners that Jesus was hanging around with were ex-sinners. They were not sinners anymore. They had repented. And these Pharisees did not connect the dots. They did not realize. They did not know that these people repented, or they didn't know the ways of God. That once you truly repent, I'm not talking about just feeling sorry. I'm talking about changing your lifestyle, changing your ways. Once you truly repent, then God doesn't see the past anymore. That is exactly what the scripture says. And that is what the Pharisees didn't see. That's what they didn't understand. And that's why they accused Jesus of being a friend to sinners, when in fact, they were the sinners. And Jesus certainly wasn't too friendly with them. Until next time, seek God with all your heart. And if you do, you will find him. Call upon him and he will show you great and mighty things. Love you guys.